We will now start. We had a little technical glitch. I'm only going to say a couple words, and then I'm going to do a brief welcome after the interpreter tells you all how to get on the functions. Ahorita les va a orientar a ustedes cómo usar el globito, la función de interpretación, de traducción, okay? Después vamos a empezar. Pero primero, muchas gracias por venir. Y ahorita con Juliana Ramírez, que nos va a ayudar de Somos Sur, equipo de traducción, para ayudar a entender cómo usar la función. Now, Juliana is going to help us understand how to use the interpretation function, and then we'll begin. Please, Juliana. We can't, I don't know if people can hear you.
Can you all hear me?
Yes, Chris.
Okay. Hola a todos. I'm not sure what's happening with Juliana, but I can take over since I'm in. I just can't turn my camera on. It says.
Go ahead. I'm gonna let you in they'll be able to see you in a minute. And very sorry, okay. Just some technical issues today. Not sure why.
It's okay.
You should be able to be on now, but anyway, go ahead. There you go. Por favor, siga.
Hey everyone. Hola a todos, mi nombre es Chris, soy intérprete con Somos Sur, la colectiva de justicia de lenguaje o de idioma en Atlanta. Hi everyone, my name is Chris, I'm an interpreter with Somos Sur, the Language Justice Collective in Atlanta. Really quick, if you are tuning in from a computer, there will be a globe on the bottom right-hand side of the computer and it says interpretation. Click on that globe and choose the language you are most comfortable with. If your language is English, leave it on English, and that way when someone is speaking Spanish, you will hear Spanish interpretation, English interpretation, and vice versa with the Spanish. Si están usando Zoom por la computadora, abajo de la pantalla va a haber un globito a su mano derecha, al pie del botón verde, donde pueden compartir su pantalla, va a estar al lado derecho de eso y dice interpretación. Escojan ese globito y opriman el idioma con que se sientan más cómodos. Si prefieren el español, dejen su idioma en español, así es que cuando estén hablando en inglés, puedan escuchar la traducción en español o la interpretación en español. If you are tuning in from your phone. Excuse my dog, I'm sorry. Also choose the interpretation. And choose the language that you are comfortable with. And it works very similarly as it does on a computer. Si están usando un celular para la interpretación, van a tener tres puntitos en su pantalla que dice que pueden escoger más cosas. Escojan el globito de interpretación, pueden escoger el idioma con que se sientan más cómodos, puede ser inglés o español. Y si son bilingües, pueden dejar la interpretación apagada para que puedan escuchar ambos idiomas con los panelistas. If you are bilingual and are comfortable with both languages, you can leave interpretation off. That way you can listen to all of the panelists as well. And if there are any questions or any difficulties throughout the time, feel free to drop them in the chat and we can try to support that way. Si tienen problemas o tienen cuestiones sobre la interpretación, pueden ponerlo en el chat y averiguamos de allí, dependiendo de lo que se necesite.
Thank you very much. Muchas gracias. I'm now going to go ahead and make these two, Juliana and Chris, interpreters. So that just takes me a second. Give me one second, and then I will start the formal presentation, which is just a brief introduction, and we'll get right to our panelists. Let me know, Chris and Juliana. I think that just did it. See? Okay, super. Okay, super. So now they can't really, well, they can kind of hear me, but I can't hear them anymore. Okay, Thank you very much for attending. Sorry, we're a couple minutes late. We'll get rolling here. Just a couple technical issues. Thanks for bearing with us. My name is Leone Jose Bicchieri. I know most of the people on. It's good to see a few new people. And thanks for bearing with us. We've done this now for 20 months or something like that. We've really enjoyed it. And thanks for sticking with us. We're now able to do some in-person meetings too, which is really cool. And so today we're going to look at local hire, targeted hire. That's a formal term. And we also use it as a little bit of a general term for how do we get the most out of our public funds. So you and I and low and moderate income people pay a disproportionate amount of our taxes, right? Of all the taxes in this country, the rich pay very little. We pay all this money. And then often government agencies get a bunch of that money. And supposedly then they should use our money to make good jobs that are available to all people, not just certain people. And so that's what we wanted to talk a little bit about today. And then you who attended, we automatically have your email. We'll give you updates on some of the campaigns that we're pushing forward together with a bunch of great allies. So local hire, targeted hire is really just saying, hey, a bunch of our money is out there. A bunch of it is designated to be for good job creation, building bridges, cleaning streets, building rail cars, and so on and so forth. But how come so many of us in really poor neighborhoods, we never seem to get a chance at those jobs? And it almost, you know, it feels like we're the ones who need them the most. So working family solidarity unites low-income workers of different backgrounds, especially African-American and Latinx, to fight together for equitable development. So we are active somewhat on housing issues as well, but promoting for the workers we organize and the folks we try to get good jobs for, trying to make sure they understand their housing options and can help us also fight for more affordable housing. So all of our great wins in labor don't turn out to just be, you know, go down the drain when our landlord raises our rent $500 in gentrifying areas. So we're gonna move ahead with our first presenter, and we're gonna do the three panelists in succession, about 15 minutes each. We'll end at about 7, could be a little before, a little after. Then we won't take any questions or comments. You can type them at any time you want in the chat. And then when we get to the end, we will go ahead and look at the questions and I'll read them out and our panelists, you know, can take a crack at them, okay? So write them whenever you'd like in Spanish or English, and then we'll go ahead and answer or react to your comment. So thank you so much for being with us. And our first panelist is Kassie Beyer. And she's the statewide director for Jobs to Move America, Illinois. And we at Working Family Solidarity are very proud to be a member of Jobs to Move America, Illinois, and fighting together with a bunch of great other organizations. And we'll hear from Kassie first. Please take it away, Kassie.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here. And we've been working with Leone for a long time. It's really amazing to be part of your network too. I am gonna share my presentation. Let's see if I can do this. Okay, and then let me put it in the right form. We're good, right? Good. Great, so I'll get us started. The U.S. governments spend about $2 trillion on goods and services every year. That's a huge amount of money. Every time I say it, it's hard for me to think about how big that is. And Jobs to Move America and kind of this work around local hire and targeted hire really starts to get into how are we buying these goods and services in a way that can incentivize high wages, more equity, and greater transparency in how public money is being spent. To say just the littlest bit about JMA, we are a national policy and organizing center. We do both. We have offices here in Illinois, California, New York, and in DC, and in Alabama. You'll notice those are four places that spend a lot of money and one place that ends up with a lot of low road manufacturing. So the idea here is that we're creating policies in our big cities that spend a lot of money to help drive up standards, not only right in our communities, but everywhere, and that we can incentivize these standards through how we are contracting, how we are purchasing goods and services through public agencies. JMA has historically worked a lot in transit, public transit, so you'll hear a lot about CTA and LA Metro and MTA, but we do work in other manufactured goods like electric vehicles, wind, and construction. So I want to run through kind of the tools in the toolbox that JMA has when we're thinking about how to create good jobs for folks who need them most, people of color, formerly incarcerated folks, women, like people who've been systemically left behind. How do we make sure that they are systemically, you know, advantaged? So the first tool I'm going to talk about today is kind of JMA's signature tool called the U.S. Employment Plan. We also call it the U.S. Jobs Plan. And what this does is changes how procurements work. So typically if an agency, and I'm going to use CTA as an example, if CTA is going to buy a bunch of buses, they're going to put out what's called an RFP, a request for proposals. And manufacturers will then submit bids to see who's going to win, right? Best value contracting is a preferred way to do contracting. A lot of time we see lowest bidder contracting where it's just like, how cheap can you do it? Great, super cheap, you win. That's not good. That's not getting us anywhere we need to be with good jobs and equity. The U.S. Employment Plan adds to, and I'm going to run through this in my next slide, but the U.S. Employment Plan adds some key jobs information to how RFPs are being evaluated, so that if you want to win a contract and it has a U.S. Employment Plan applied to the RFP, you're more likely to win if you're committing to create more jobs, higher wages, better benefits, you have a better plan to recruit marginalized workers who have systemically been excluded. You have community partnerships. All of that gets evaluated and scored. And if you win the contract, all of that stuff you said, how much you're going to pay, how many jobs you're going to create, all that good stuff becomes part of the binding contract with the agency. So you'll see on the screen here, lowest bidder, we hate that. That's no good. That's not getting us where we want to be. You'll see in the middle here, best value. This is allowing an agency, again, to look at more than just price. So this is kind of what CTA typically does. They're going to look at technology, the timeline, the past performance, and the managerial style of companies. So they're not just buying the lowest priced bus. They're buying a bus that also has good technology from a company that can produce it on time. And that has a track record of doing this well. And then what we do, what Jobs to Move America does, is asks, you know, has agencies like CTA do all that stuff. All that stuff's great. we want good vehicles, but we also want to make sure those vehicles are supporting good jobs in communities where these vehicles are being built. So what we do is add, again, that U.S. Employment Plan, that U.S. Jobs Plan criteria where manufacturers are submitting not only all the price and technology and all of that, they're also telling us how many jobs are you creating or retaining with this money that you want to receive from this agency? What are the wages and benefits you're going to pay workers? What's your plans for training and apprenticeship programs for those workers? What's your commitment to recruiting marginalized workers? This is usually a percentage, and that's, you know, legally usually defined as single parents, folks exiting foster care, formerly incarcerated people who face systemic and multiple barriers to employment. We want to make sure that the manufacturers are really thinking about the right plans to recruit those folks and retain those folks. And then it also evaluates bidders on partnerships. So manufacturers are pretty good at building their bus or their train or their windmill, but they're not always great at their workforce stuff. So we really, really want to make sure manufacturers are working with folks like people on this call who have deep roots in the communities, who know people, who can make these connections and make sure folks have support they need to enter these jobs and be successful. So that's kind of the U.S. Employment Plan. And that fits really nicely with kind of the next tool in JMA's toolbox, which are community benefits agreements. I know folks hear a lot about these. They're very exciting tools for communities to be able to organize around. So folks may know the history here, but I'll share a little bit. Community benefits agreements originated in Los Angeles. And it happened, their Dodger Stadium wanted to relocate in a primarily Mexican neighborhood. Were set to just squash the neighborhood, dislocate everybody from their homes, and just we're gonna get away with it. So communities and organizations started organizing folks in that neighborhood to fight back. And through a very long campaign, we're able to win the first community benefits agreement in the country. And I'm happy to say JMA's executive director negotiated that first contract, that first CBA. And we have kind of a rich history of continuing to think about how community benefits agreement can exist not only for development, which is very important, especially in big cities where there is a lot of displacement and a lot of gentrification, but also kind of thinking about community benefits as agreements as a tool for workers and for workplaces. So that's where this kind of manufacturing piece comes from. You'll notice these partnerships, these community benefits agreements, these agreements often cover things, our community benefits agreements, I should say, often cover things like job quality, and help, you know, help workers have a fair process to organize if they choose to do so. It often covers training and apprenticeship programs that workers need to be successful. Nobody intuitively knows how to build an electric bus until they get the right training and the credentials. We want these to be certified credentials and transferable. So it's not just a path to one employer, it's a path to a career that you can take and you know, be successful regardless.
Kassie, yeah. I'm interrupting you. Your time is not up. I just wanted to make sure I think I see one of the interpreters saying, if you can talk a tiny bit slower.
Okay.
And they tell me all the time, so don't feel bad.
No problem. And I'm keeping time, Leone, so. yes, I'll speak slower. I apologize. And then the community benefits agreement that JMA have negotiated also include a minimum percentage of workers from marginalized backgrounds. So really getting a firm commitment on the number of people who will be prioritized for hiring who face systemic barriers to employment. Because these are private agreements, we are able to specifically name race and gender. So a lot of our community benefits agreements say a minimum of 40% people of color, women, Latinos, Black folks, really making sure that we're naming and we're specific about that, because we do have the ability to go a little further than kind of government contracts can. I'm gonna point something out here. You see how I put this in yellow? If we go back to my other slide, you see how there's some things in yellow here? These are the same things. the idea here is that we're creating policy that's really setting up workers and communities to be able to organize, to have the kind of relationship with developers, with manufacturers, with folks who are choosing to locate in their communities, who are receiving public money, who often on top of those public contracts are receiving tax incentives and any number of, you know, sweet deals that all these big businesses get. And so the idea here is we're kind of setting ourselves up for success in our policy and how we're doing public contracting in order to create space for folks on the ground, communities, workers to organize around the things that are most important to them in as these big businesses are showing up in their communities. I'll also add that this is not the limit to what can go in a CBA. This is not required as to what goes in a CBA. CBAs are made by the people who organize and fight for them and who negotiate them, and those decisions are made by them. But these are what we've often been able to see and win in our CBAs. I'm gonna give one more CBA thing. Here, I also wanted to just kind of flesh out the relationship a little bit here. On the left, you'll see when a a developer in this case or a manufacturer comes to town, there's all these groups on the left side. You see unions, environmental groups, churches, affordable housing. There's all these groups who all do great work, who run to the city and say, hey, city, we need this. We need good jobs. We need affordable housing. We need our folks prioritized for these jobs. And then the city takes that information and maybe, I guess, will go to the developer and say, yeah, there's these people, you know, saying they need these things. And the difference here with a CBA are twofold. One, we do that organizing, right? So instead of being one, like little groups all kind of going and to the city and trying to get their little piece of the pie, we form a coalition of groups that can unite around these shared goals. People are dimensional, people need good jobs and racial equity and environmental equity and affordable housing. Like you can unite folks around all of their different needs and you can create like a coherent demand. So that coalition is still engaging the city. And they then create the community benefits agreement and have a direct relationship with that manufacturer or that developer. So this is a really good tool to have in the toolbox. I will say CBAs are not guaranteed. I know a lot of folks are really excited about them, but it does take a smart strategic campaign to win them. And I'll talk a little about that right now too. So just as an FYI, the US Employment Plan has been used 13 times by different transit agencies, applying to over $8 billion of money. The US Employment Plan with a CBA created the first electric school bus pre-apprenticeship and apprenticeship programs in the country. And the policies that we're working on at just CTA and LA Metro, LA's transit agency, if applied to all of their contracts moving forward, would support up to 41,000 good jobs across the country. So big, big, big. The folks you see in this photo are Chicago workers that work at a facility called CRRC. We had a community benefits agreement with this company that created a jobs pipeline, hiring commitments from the 10th Ward, and our coalition is currently working on that. It is not all puppies and rainbows and sunshine. It's hard work, but we're getting there and we're doing it differently than when a big company comes to town. These are the first graduates from the electric bus apprenticeship program that I mentioned. These are the first graduates of the first program, all folks from LA County, which is very exciting. And today, FYI, big news, JMA won a community benefits agreement today. So it was a very exciting day to be talking to you. Our coalition in Alabama fought very hard and won a community benefits agreement that covers both Alabama and California manufacturing facilities with a company called New Flyer. New Flyer is the largest bus manufacturer in the country, in North America, in fact. And if you're a Chicago person and you look out your window, there's a good chance you see a New Flyer bus going by. So this means we're going to be able to see buses in our communities that were made with high road jobs, with racial equity, with a fair process for workers to organize, which is very exciting. I want to talk a little about local hire and targeted hire. This is another tool in our toolbox. These usually refer to construction projects. So I've been talking about manufacturing, which is a big piece of the puzzle. Construction is also a big piece of the puzzle. The local hire refers to a policy that requires employers, usually a general contractor, to set aside a certain percent of jobs for a local community. And targeted hire goes even a step further and allows those policies to set aside jobs for people who face barriers to employment. These policies can also require that a certain percent come from union hiring halls or from community-based workforce organizations. Two really big things that I want to emphasize before, I know I'm going a little over, Leonin, sorry. These policies need to be designed and implemented with communities. These are not automatically wins for communities unless communities are involved in designing them. Often this looks like advisory committees, connecting residents to the jobs and helping identify projects that make sense for workers and for communities. It also is very important that these policies have teeth. If you just say you got to do local hire and there's no real like stick if they don't do it, that's a problem. So all of these need to have very strong enforceability, like liquidated damages, withholding milestone payments, and even debarment, so that a contractor, if they're consistently not making their local hire or targeted hire commitments, that they can just be cut off from public contract. I'll say just a little more here. The local hire and targeted hire was banned in 1980 during the Reagan administration, because he saw as federal money was coming down to cities and states were organizing around the anti-apartheid movement and were trying to steer their money away from businesses that were actively supporting, you know, apartheid in South Africa. So Reagan obviously didn't like that and cut it off, so that these cities and communities that wanted to support workers and racial equity weren't able to do that. Fortunately, we're undoing this. JMA is helping at the national level change this, so that cities like Chicago, County, Illinois, that once that federal money is arriving in our bank accounts, our city's bank account and at agencies, they do have this tool to really make sure that the work is not only getting the project done, but supporting racial equity, supporting high road jobs, and making communities like a better and safer place to live. Fortunately, the infrastructure bill that passed included turning over this. So DOT contracts, Department of Transportation contracts, are now allowed to apply local hire and targeted hire, which means CTA is taking this up, and the Illinois DOT kind of highway construction. We'll see a lot more of this coming soon. We are still working to overturn the rules that restrict it on everything else. So these rules exist at the OMB, the Office of Management and Budget, at the national level. And when we can overturn these rules, it will give cities and states a lot more movement, a lot more flexibility to make sure that money is being steered toward people who need them most and communities that need it most. So that work is ongoing. We're working to organize in Chicago to make sure the federal government knows that we are part of this coordinated effort to overturn this ban and make sure that we do have this tool in our toolbox. And that's my presentation. Thank you guys so much. My email is here. I also put it in the chat. Feel free to reach out with any questions. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Kassie. And yes, and we basically just started everything 2-3 minutes late with a couple technical glitches. And that was great stuff. Again, I will proudly say that Working Family Solidarity is a member of the Jobs to Move America Illinois Coalition, and we will be following up. There's a little more I was going to work in about some other things we're doing at Working Family Solidarity on around planned manufacturing districts and some other industrial zoning. I may say a little bit less. I'll see if there's any time later before we sign off, but we'll be following up with people about a lot of details, kind of a lot of information to throw out today, but whether it's in a certain industrial zone, planned manufacturing district, infrastructure bill, there's so many ways that local hire, targeted hire is both a very specific practice and sort of a general philosophy that we're trying to really bring people together around, and not sort of ask for good jobs, but you know, you took my last $10 out of my pocket and now I can, and you didn't use it in a way that helps me and my family in the slightest. And that's what's happening. They're taking our money, low and medium income families, where depending on how you want to statistically look at it, are we 90%, 99%? But we're the vast majority of all humans in this country. we get all our money taken and it goes to help other people and it doesn't come back to us. And when we get it, we're made to feel bad. Oh, your welfare. What do you mean welfare? That's our money. We've earned it and we paid for it, right? We're the reason Social Security exists. It's our money. It doesn't come from rich folks. So that's what we want to get philosophically back to people. So not just that the kind of things Kassie was talking about, which are super important. That's why we're part of JMA Illinois. But so how do we do it? But also just the whole philosophy that this is not entitlement for us. Our money's been taken. It's been taken, right? And they won't give it back. And until we have that attitude, we're not going to change this, right? We don't have to be violent about it, but we can just be honest about it. What did you do with all of our money? Right? Because I don't see it. And I don't see jobs in my community. Moving from Kassie to Tameka, we're going to go with Tameka Gavin, who works with Cook County Restorative Justice in Englewood area. She'll tell us a little more about her work. I'm really proud. She and I have known each other several years. We've collaborated together, worked together on all kinds of things. And we're really lucky to have her and some of the insights on what she sees in her work and why she thinks what I was just talking about is important, that we try to reclaim some of that for a lot of us who normally don't get it, and also especially for youth. So Tameka, please take it away.
Thank you, Leone, and good evening, everyone. My name is Tameka Gavin. I work for the Restorative Justice Community Courts of Cook County Circuit Courts. We have three community courts so far. North Lawndale, which was the first community court. We now have Avondale Park, and we have Englewood, which is the branch that I'm in. Pretty much what I do there, first of all, let me just explain the process of how participants come to the community courts. If they are arrested, whether this is their first arrest ever, or they're getting ready to get charged with a felony, and they've had no other felonies prior to this one, then 26 in California looks at their zip code and figure out which court they are going to send the participants to, because the justice community have, they feel that, you know, there has been some injustice, you know, within our communities. So they want to go about it in a restorative manner. And what better way than to pretty much get a case dismissed and a record expunged than to have them go through the restorative process, which is peace circles and committing to a repair harm agreement. And not just that, but also getting the participants to actually get jobs, build educational needs, do life skills training, job placement. We give them social support and just resources of that nature, or what we call, those are our program components. So once a participant comes to us with his case or her case, because we do have women as well, we pretty much sit them in front of the judge. The judge lets them know that what they're going to be volunteering for, because this is not mandatory. They do not have to do this. They can opt out. And once the individual agrees to volunteering in this program, then we start the process of the peace circles, and we start the process of finding the participant resources that they need to become a better citizen. We do not call them offenders, because they're not. We call them participants. They have not been charged with anything just yet. So when we're working to get the case expunged, we're working to get the case dismissed, so they're not a convicted felon or anything of that nature. But we've noticed that a lot of our participants who come to us They don't have a criminal record at all. They have lack of education. They have lack of employment. They may need some therapy. And so that's where we fill in the gaps. If they need those resources met, then we're going to find them a job. And we partner with the Safer Foundation is one of the organizations. Another organization, which is right downstairs from us, is the Centers for New Horizons, who actually work with the participants with job placement, job readiness skills, educational training, just basic services that will kind of like enhance their ability of looking for a job and actually getting that job. We do this because we do not want them to result back to 26 in California. So we notice that if they are busy, if they're kept busy, then they will not have time to, you know, pivot into what we say is kind of like destruction. That it'll be something positive. They'll, instead of them going to hang out with their friends, they will come to a peace circle, or they will be going to work or school or something of that nature. And we have a lot of young men who are interested in manufacturing, which is, and carpentry. And I mean, I'm just floored by the things that they tell us and the actual classes that they're enrolling in. With one of them being, which I didn't even know this, cannabis. I did not know that that they had classes on actually growing cannabis and marketing cannabis. Had no idea. But this is something that our participants, they have a knack for, and this is what they want to do. So pretty much what we've been doing is expanding our outreach with the courts in at 26 in California, which is needed because a lot of the attorneys that take the cases, they don't know that that this program exists. And when they can be working on something else and just give what one of the attorneys say, give the busy work to us, then they can do that. We also like to educate our employers on the value of using our participants. Some of them really are great workers. They just never had a chance to actually get a job. They didn't know how to fill out a job application. This is where we come in at. This is what we do. And we kind of don't mind making our, I'm sorry for my alarm, but we don't mind making our employers aware of this is how our participants feel. This is what they're feeling. They're feeling like they're not valued. So we put all of that into perspective for the partners, which are our employers as well, so that our people, our participants can get a fair wage. they're not a convicted felon. Another thing that we're working on, which is part of policy that we were talking to our judge about, is when our participants go for a job and the question is asked, have you been convicted of a crime? Do they put yes or do they put no? The answer is no, they do not. They have not been convicted. However, when they run their backgrounds, it says pending. So the judge advised us to let our participants know that they should state what it is that they were arrested for, but no, there has been no conviction. And that it may be, if they run their names, the word pending will come across that their backgrounds. Another thing that I wanted to talk about is I also work with youth. And I love to use the peace circles as a part of bringing the youth together so that they can experience the dialogue, because we do know that a lot of times, a lot of boys, especially boys of color, miss out on the social emotional needs, and they don't know how to talk it out, and they don't know how to let things go. So the peace circles, which is something that we do at the court, is so dynamic in that the youth that I work with want to do a peace circle every single week. They bring up their own topics. I let them facilitate it because now they know how, but it's really good, a really great process, because it pivots their mental state of, I don't have to be big and bad and tough anymore. I can talk it out with my brother, my friend, my sister, my mom, my dad, my cousin. And so I think I've been rambling on it. I think I will wait for the questions that you guys have for me. I think I will do that, because I will just keep going on and on.
Well, I think you would go on and on. I think people would listen on and on. I've known you a long time, and I'm listening, and I'm picking up on new stuff. Really appreciate it, Tameka, very much. And yeah, we'll have question and answer. There's been a couple of things put down in the question and answer sort of box that I can look at, and a couple of comments in chat. I think Kassie's already answered one, which is great. But yeah, put anything in the chat at any time you'd like. And after Dolores Castañeda, who will present next after her presentation, then we will look through those questions and comments and so on. And we'll make sure that each panelist, if the questions or comments go a little more naturally to one or two, we'll make sure that they're all involved and can sort of comment or answer questions and so on. So thank you very much, Tameka. We are now going to go to Dolores Castañeda, a good friend of mine, longtime activist in Little Village and beyond, and also active at UIC School of Public Health and with the Greater Lawndale Healthy Work Project, which she's going to tell us a little bit about. And I am going to assist by screen sharing the presentation and then taking instructions from Dolores on when to turn the page. So we will go ahead. Please start, Dolores, and I'll get this on the screen in just a moment.
Okay, but thank you for the opportunity to be here, and it's a pleasure to explain a little bit about that project we have in UIC, and yeah, I'm waiting for that.
Yeah, give me one second here. Okay, give me one second. I'm trying to get to a regular view here. Give me one second. Okay, now let me see here. Okay.
Okay, thank you, Leone.
Yep, just let me know when you want me to change the page.
Of course. Like Leone explained, we in North London and South London, and I'm part of UIC, Greater Lawndale Project, Healthy Work, and we're working in this project for 5 years already, and we make a lot of accomplishments in this project, but I'm gonna show a little bit about what we're doing. Okay, next, please. Thank you. And our mission is to turn Healthy Work into Healthy Work. And we contribute to local and state national programs to policies to promote healthier working conditions, to provide more fair employment and decent job for the workers. And next one, please. Over here, Great London Healthy Work Project is a community-based participatory resource project in North London and Little Village, and we together working and try to find solution about in healthy jobs we facing every single day in Little Village in North London. And the most I like this project is like we invite community members to be in that table to provide information about how we can make more healthy jobs in these communities. And like we invest and part in this community, Little Village. We always had different kind of projects. Like over here, you can see Chicago Tribune. We had a lot of vaccine events in the community. When we see a lot of mortality, COVID in this community in North London too, we start to getting together community members and start getting vaccines and vaccinate the community. And over here in North London, we have more infograms about information how to protect people about COVID, how to provide information or resource for get the vaccine. And over here, you can see me. I was involved in La Tortilleria. We have a lot of workers who want to the tortilleria pay better and more better treatment. And unfortunately, a lot of people die during COVID because they don't have like the protection for the workers. And we start demanding more sick days and better pay for these workers. And over here you see parent, the people who is part in this project. We have community members. We have different organizations who participate with us to find solution about to transform this informal workers and more formal and more benefits. Next one, please. Thank you. Can you make it more bigger for me, please? Thank you.
I'm not sure if I can.
Okay, that's
sorry.
Okay.
I think that's I've got my screen full, so I think that's about it.
Okay, that's fine.
Sorry. Here, I'll try this.
Yeah, that's fine.
A little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. We applied like a 500 questionnaires, half in North London and half in Little Village, and this is the data we have. You know, like infer all the barriers that resident has to keep good jobs, and most of the jobs cause a lot of stress. No, they don't know at what time they're gonna start working because they change the schedules constantly. It's not enough pay to cover all the vaccine needs in the house. Don't offer benefits and it's dangerous jobs. And I see in my community, especially I see people working in temp agency when they not pay these people or they take away all the benefits, they don't have no benefits in these agencies. And this is the other data we find is they stolen the salaries, working, they not value the working, they looking the worker like a disposable workers. And this is, they try to put the workers against one worker to another, to just see how they explore more these workers. And the barriers to is high quality education and quality in trainings. And this is the thing we need to get more jobs, like to benefit the community. Next one, please. And we're talking about what is healthy jobs. And healthy jobs is more safe and pay the workers and have benefits, pay sick days, family leave days. And the other thing is head a community when the worker have enough pay or when the worker has stable jobs, the community is more healthy because constantly the people in the community consider about how they're gonna pay the rent, how they're gonna provide food when sometimes they need to have two jobs to cover the basic needs. Next one, please. Over here, I had this picture about workers who die in the workplace or die a consequence of the job they do. And this is take my, one is my passion because my husband died in the workplace. And this is that thing we always silence about it. Sometimes we not say anything because we want to lose the jobs. And I see so many people in the community go through this kind of situation. And over here you see a street vendor. This, you can see this lady is an older lady and is still working in the streets. And you see this young man roofing, working. And a lot of accidents happen because these people not have benefits. They not covered in case something happened. And this is the thing we want to figure it out, how to have very healthy jobs in the community. Next one, please. Over here, we had vaccinated jornaleros in Home Depot, and they the one who's helped me to promote the vaccine, and we have a lot of information for them, resource to where can go, or we go over there and vaccinate ourselves to the jornaleros. Next one, please. Over here, you can see some picture of when we vaccinate people. Next one. We Great London Loteria, we make a loteria. It's more like a Latino game, but we turn this game in like a we have images about workers, and we have explained a little bit what is workers go through every single day. And we try with this loteria, people understand the various the worker experience every single day. Like, for example, like a street vendor, they're exposed to temperature, they don't have insurance, they don't have time for themselves, they're exposed to police brutality. And all these barriers we explain in this loteria, and we try to promote more awareness about unhealthy jobs. And I understand a lot of people in my community, they're not thinking about healthy jobs because they never be exposed to this kind of job. They never thinking about, you know, sick days or personal days or insurance, things like that, because all the jobs they expose is this kind of precarious job. Next one, please. Over here, we working in collaborativas in the community and try to have more like a small business has their own grants to continue open the business, because now with COVID, a lot of small business, they need to close because they can afford it to continue keeping open. Next one, please. Over here, we had informal workers, and we try to the informal worker to have in the mind to thinking in healthy jobs. And for informal workers, we have advocates for policies and try to have more like information for these informal workers to understand they deserve better jobs. And We put in this table a business, a small business, and people from the community to understand a little bit how we can go to that, make this goal come true, and, you know, like have more healthy jobs. Next one, please. And we had like COVID stories. We had a participant, we had your locally in Free Spirit, whose young adults interviewed 23 participants. And we training these young men who trauma-informed training to do that interview. And in this project, we hear a lot of stories about losing jobs, losing community members, all the streets they go through, and we try to we had a implement more like understand more about COVID and to support this community in that way that we want to hear the voices from the community and understand to provide better healthy jobs. And over here, yes, the next one, please. Over here, yes, the information for UIC and the telephone number and the website and everything. Next one, please. And this is the founding statement, and you can see we have this total worker healthy to provide more funding to the UIC to continue to do this resource. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Dolores. So we got off to a couple minute late start, but we actually did a great job and we're just pretty much right on time. It's 7:02 on my clock, and we will have until 7:25 to answer some questions and respond to some comments. There are a couple of questions in the question box, which I will let the panelists know about. And then we will, while the panelists are answering or commenting or whatever for a few minutes, I will go through the chat and see if there's anything else in there that's been unanswered. Please feel free to write any other comment or question. And you will notice this last comment I wrote in the chat, I mentioned Chris White, a good friend of mine and an organizer with ASE, the Association of the Southeast. And he's also been heading up the what we've been calling CEDAR, the Citywide Equitable Development Roundtable, which we at Working Family Solidarity are part of. And the city is looking at a bunch of zoning laws for the first time in a bunch of years and decades. And so I urge you, and we will do this with all of you. We will keep your emails and we will follow up about the different projects and campaigns we're talking about today, because we at Working Family Solidarity are supporting the roundtable to make sure that the city hears from the community and understands that if you're gonna be rezoning, make sure it's not for the developers, the investors, and the bankers, like it is the vast majority of the time, but actually make it things that human beings need: affordable housing, green space, jobs, job training centers, and so on. So we will follow up in emails to let you know more about what Chris is doing, the round table, and a bunch of really important things. Let me go to one of the questions in the question box. Let's see here. So one of them was that there have been some complaints, and this is, I think, just going out generally, so it might be, see who takes a crack at it, but there's been some complaints that building trades, local hire agreements are problematic. This might be a little more towards you, Kassie, but others can comment on this or this general thought. They can be problematic because A, people get dropped when the location changes, and B, there are some projects like O'Hare, for example, in segregated areas where local hiring is not equitable, because the whole city needs that work. Are you aware of the ordinance that Chicago Women in Trades is promoting about inclusion? If you know about it, what do you think of it? I don't know if you want to take a crack at that, Kassie. Yeah, please go ahead.
I got it. Yeah, this is a good question. I hear it a lot, and it's a concern. I think anybody who, candidly, the building trades have not had a great track record working with people of color and women. The organizations have often kind of benefited the sons and friends of folks who are already been able to make it into the ranks. That being said, the one of the things I emphasized is the need to have community partners part of defining how and when and what targeted hire and local hire should look like. JMA is working on a set of recommendations right now. They'll be coming out soon as more and more cities pick up local hire policies, especially with this new permission from DOT. And you know, there's just going to be a lot more local hire happening. That being said, I would, one of our recommendations that I know exists from our experience in LA and Los Angeles, which has had local hire for a long time, is to be careful about how small to make your community. So we would never recommend framing the local as smaller than the county level. And then kind of being smart and strategic about using EDAs or economically disadvantaged areas kind of zip code targeting to make sure that the people who do need jobs, who do need training, who do need access to apprenticeships are being set up for that success. And there's not this kind of whiplash of, you know, there's only projects on the south side right now, so the west side guy can't get hired. Like that's not what we want to set up. We want to make sure that local is big enough to give folks agility to move from project to project. I hope that helps. And I'm not familiar with the CWIT ordinance, but I would like to hear more about it.
Yeah, Chris, if you want to put anything more in the chat about that ordinance, but we, you know, we can, Working Family Solidarity and JMA Illinois and stuff, we can follow up. I will tell you this, Chris, and others as well on this. I've been part of some national discussions every 2 weeks, sort of an ad hoc group. And I get on to report back to Jobs to Move America Illinois on what folks are talking about. And Jobs to Move America nationally has folks on the call, as do folks from a whole bunch of different trade unions and great organizations across the country. And just so you know, Chris, you know, women in trades have been on those national calls as well. So they've definitely been kind of keeping in front of us, like, how do we make sure that the so-called inclusive agreements are actually inclusive? And interestingly enough, I think that's what, you know, we're not, for example, at Work and Family Solidarity, we're not technically part of Women in Trades, but that's exactly what we're trying to do. And I think, you know, Kassie and Jobs to Move America, you know, Tameka's not necessarily working on this in the same way we are, but, and Dolores maybe a slightly different, but ultimately I think that really sums up what we're all trying to do, right? Just to kind of note that we're really all working on the same thing, maybe from slightly different angles. And again, that is, we're the richest country on earth. We have a massive tax break. We have massive public funds. Where are they in terms of jobs? We could ask that for a lot of other things, healthcare and housing and everything, right? But where is the money that's coming back to these government agencies, specifically to either clean, repair, build, and supposedly to use it to strengthen our economy? So, I, you know, all the different angles, the more the merrier. And I think one of the things we're really trying to promote is we learn about the different ways we're working in Northeastern Illinois, and we try to find ways to collaborate. So we might not all work together in one big coalition exactly the same, but we got to promote each other's campaigns and projects, and also find out how, you know, if we're going to do something at Working Family Solidarity, we have to make it so that it helps some other organization with their campaign, right? So we got to just find these different ways we can kind of push each other forward, because we're really all connected. The Equitable Development Roundtable, we're all talking about the same thing. We just got to like sharpen our focus together. One question was submitted that was asking Tameka, I'll go ahead and just read it exactly here. What industries are Tameka's program participants finding work on? Are there some that are the most common? Are there some that are growing? As far as jobs, I think.
So some of the jobs have been in hospitality, manufacturing, carpentry, welding, I think food service, is another one, and entrepreneurship has been very, very lucrative with our participants. They, for whatever reason, feel like they want to start their own clothing line and different things of that nature. And some of them are doing the airbrushing or shoe designing or something on gym shoes. Really interesting. They're very creative. But those are the workforce industries.
Thank you. I just want to make sure that all the different, you know, all the different panelists each have a crack, because something might kind of go a little more towards one or the other, but we want to make sure everyone can say something. Dolores, I don't know if you wanted to take a couple minutes to add anything on the two things that have been discussed, either just the importance in any other thing you didn't say, which maybe you've said it all, but any other way, just how important these jobs are to folks that don't have them, that they're actually decent jobs. And also just coming out from the industries, are there certain industries you're seeing that you think are either particularly negative that we don't want more of because they're dangerous or not well regulated, or certain types of jobs that you think would be especially beneficial to folks in the Greater Lawndale area?
For me, we have Target warehouse over here, and they really not hiring a lot of people from that community. And they had a pollution when they put that Target in that community, but they say they're gonna be just for community members, and really it's only a few jobs. And for me, be honest with you, we know really healthy jobs in that community. Be in that community, and only I can see is in healthy jobs or precarious jobs in the community. And I'm glad I can hear Kassie and Tameka, because I'm interested in seeing more like a jobs for people with us in jail and understand more the whole process. And for me, learning this is important to pass this information to the community. But my question is, Kassie, about, are you willing to, for people who's not documented, no have documentation, because sometimes it's a barrier for community member for documentation situation. They always thinking they never gonna have a job, decent jobs, because for that situation.
I can say what, it's a really challenging issue, and because we're dealing with public funds, folks who aren't documented are often, there's just more scrutiny for employers who are dealing with public funds, and it's very, very difficult for people who don't have papers to work in those places. That being said, I think it's very important to kind of open up as many opportunities as possible. And I think also working with union partners who can negotiate additional protections in their contracts for immigrant workers and for undocumented workers in particular. So it's a really difficult situation because there is so much scrutiny, but I do think there is some room to move and make it better for folks.
Thank you.
Can I say something to that, Dolores? I just wanted to say, coming off my point just before you spoke, I think that's the importance of as many of us as possible to work together, even if we're not working, you know, every day for hours. But if we could do that, that's wonderful. But at least understanding the different types of mm-hmm. organizations and projects and campaigns. So if one is working with the Chicago Transit Authority to push the infrastructure dollars to make sure that they're used for really good jobs, which is one of the things that we're doing with Jobs to Move America, Illinois, some of that federal funding, Dolores, of course, means, and anytime you get federal, right, then you get strict immigration stuff. And so, you know, we kind of have to figure out, where do we want to resist that and say, hey, that's BS. Where do we want to say, okay, look, let's do what we can with those jobs. But that's why I think, and I mentioned this a couple of times, I think it's good to look at local hire, targeted hire as a policy, but a lot of that policy has restrictions when you adhere to the exact policy. And that's why I said, I think we also want to do it in community organizing as a philosophy. So not just a policy, because the philosophy for local hire, targeted hire for me, Dolores, is human beings that live here should work here. Because if you buy gasoline, you're paying tax, a whole lot of tax right now. If every time you buy something, you're paying tax, right? Every time you pick up the phone, every time you pay your phone bill, right? So we're all paying into this system that then excludes people because in Tameka's, you know, the work she does, because, you know, you did something stupid when you were 15. And instead of living in the suburb where they say, ah, whatever, go home. I know your dad, whatever, get out of here, kid. That's what the jail folks do, right? I know, because I've seen it with my own eyes. I know people. And in the city, you know, like someone said, we get busted because we're going through puberty and we go to jail for doing silly things. Or they get the Latino community, they get us in the Latinx community through the immigration stuff. So that's where I think we have to come together and say, you know, there's this kind of campaign for local hire. There's the plan manufacturing districts that we're pushing. That doesn't have anything to do with documents. So we have to somehow find these different ways so that there's a door for more people. Because if people aren't excited about, they may know that they won't necessarily get a job if something passes. But if they feel like they're going to have a chance at those jobs or people they know, they're going to fight for it. Right. And if not, people aren't going to get very excited. So please continue, Dolores. I just wanted to add that comment.
Thank you. The Tina, it made me talking with the community members and asking about what do you healthy yeah for you? What is you? And they asked me, what do you mean that, you know, like they don't get it, what I try to tell them, because they never exposed to nothing healthy. Everything is precarious jobs, exploitation, and injustice. And these people, when you start asking that about, okay, healthy jobs, you can have insurance, you can have benefits, you can have all this, they always say, oh, that is not for me because I don't have documentation. You know, it's like the reality happened in the community. But I see your point, Leone, about learning more about people who have the opportunity to have healthy jobs, things like that. You know?
Yeah, we're not going to do it alone. And I mean, working family solidarity was one major factor in our formation about 5.5 years ago, was to bring together low-income workers of different backgrounds, especially African-American and Latinx, because we're pitted against each other, right? And it's often in the area of jobs and housing. So, you know, when a Latino goes to apply, he or she is told, well, there's 10 positions, let's see. And so people are automatically thinking, I better beat those Black folks because they're going to try to apply. And Black folks are like, uh-oh, I better hurry up because those Latinos, I saw them lining up to apply for, you know, to go out this morning in the temp work, right? And so there's enough jobs for all of us, right? But we've been trained to think it's a zero-sum game. And so we have to kind of replace someone else, and there's actually enough money for all of us. But so we just got to figure out, because there's so many smart people organizing and very dedicated, right? And we just got to figure out how to work together and be a little bit stronger. I wanted to also say to Tameka that someone had a question just to ask, that they asked a little bit more about what you do. So I think they understood kind of generally what you do, but so like a little, maybe a couple more, a minute or two more on like what you do. You go talk to the judge, or you go talk to the youth, or what do you do?
I do both.
and then also, if there's any other detail about what's your role or people you work with, and then like they how do they then, who talks to them about, okay, look, there's some jobs out there as well. Like, just tell us a little more how you do that.
Okay, so I'm part of the case management team. And what I failed to actually say is that the services that we provide for the participants, they have to be the ages from 18 to 26 years old. And pretty much what I do is find them resources so that they can get their case dismissed and eventually expunged, the record expunged. And what we do is we actually come up with a repair of harm agreement. And what that is a contract that this person signs stating that, yes, I want to enroll in your program here at the RJCC courts. I will come to circles. I will share. This is part of me saying that I'm sorry to the community that I've hurt, whether I have did something wrong to someone, or if I had a gun or had marijuana on me, I've hurt the community. So in order for them to get their case dismissed, they have to come up with 5 or more goals, being, I want to get my GED, I need a job. And we throw in extra, like we would like to see a vision board. And while they're naming the things that they need, I'm finding the resources for them in their area. We are coming up with issues about now crossing boundaries, which I thought was really over for the young adults. I thought that was over, but it's not, because of all the violence. So if they live in Auburn Gresham, I have to find them something that is closer to Auburn Gresham. They really can't come and engage in a program in Englewood if they belong to a certain gang. It's just all kind of different facets to this, and just making sure that I get to the nitty gritty of knowing who they are and building relationships with them so I can know what to do for them. It's pretty much what me and the people that I work with, we do. In all the three communities that the courts are in, we're pretty much faced with the same issues. So did I explain that?
Thank you. Yes. And I think, you know, it's sort of part of it is how much can we work into a limited amount of time, but really great stuff. I can, you know, you know me, I'll definitely be following up with you, partly personally, but also, you know, so that we can, as we work on the trying to do advance the local hire, targeted hire, both again as more of a formal kind of approach with the infrastructure dollars and stuff, but also just in the community with the planned manufacturing districts and just the different industrial zones in Englewood and, you know, and the various ones throughout the city, you know, trying to, a lot of the planned manufacturing districts and similar industrial zones were actually conceived by Harold Washington. And didn't some of them just got started when he passed away. So he didn't see some of a lot of them starting. But the whole idea of the planned manufacturing districts and then various other industrial zoning is that people in neighborhoods that might not be the most wealthy and where people maybe can't, you know, or don't want to get all the way out to another suburb, you know, an hour away to work and then come back in an hour and can't see your kids. You know, the kids suffer, the schoolwork suffers, you hardly are home. So the idea is how about having good jobs in different neighborhoods so that people in those areas don't maybe can walk or take a short bus ride and work and then go home. And actually, you know, then they're going to spend the money in the community. It's going to strengthen the community. So we'll follow up with you, Tameka. And it's my way of really just saying, because we're going to get to a moment here where I'm going to, we're going to have to end here, but we're going to end with each panelist with any last comments. But you know, for me, Tameka, a lot of the stuff you're talking about with the youth, again, it just makes me feel like how the system we currently have really finds a way not to include but to exclude, and how it's done to Black folks has been so much through the criminal justice system, the war on drugs, now that white kids, right, are overdosing in trailer parks, now it's more accepted that it's a problem and we should all, you know, try to solve it. But before it was a bunch of people doing, you know, really acting in really evil ways. So when it was sort of Black folks doing it, and then with Latinos, we get some of that, but we get the immigration. And then with the white workers, it's a little more like, you guys shouldn't complain, even though you have trouble meeting your monthly rent and mortgage, you're not doing very well. There are more whites that live in poverty than Blacks or Latinos in this country, right? A greater percentage of Blacks live in poverty, but more whites live in poverty and are on quote unquote entitlement programs. But this system makes sure that non-people of color workers somehow in their mind think they're better off just because they're white. They don't get harassed when they go to the mall. You know, they don't, if they're messing around on a bus, some two young white kids, they probably get left alone. Ah, sit down, guys. Ha ha ha. If it's two Black kids, they call the cops, right? And so what we have to be with local hire, targeted hire, is about inclusion, right? We don't care where you come from, man. We don't care what your first language is. We don't care if you're tall, short, left, right, up, down. You deserve a job, right? Come on. And it's going to help all of us. So as we finish here, which will be in the next couple of minutes, I want to see if each panelist has any last 1 minute or so comment to add before I just kind of thank everyone and we close. We can start, we can go right back to you, Tameka, and any last thing you want to say before we finish?
No, but I said no, but yes, I just would definitely love to connect. I think it's so important. The work that we do is just so very important. And Leone, I need you to sit me at the tables of any of the roundtables that you all have regarding the local hire, target hire. I think that was an excellent point. I love that idea as well.
Awesome. Awesome, Tameka. And because I'm recording, I now have it, you know, like I have proof that you told me I could follow up with you. So, you know, then when I'm bugging you, you're like, man, Leone, can you leave me alone for just half an hour? I can be like, you said I could call. No, thanks so much, Tameka. Thank you very, very much. And let's go to Dolores. Dolores, do you want to have any last comment? Pretty short before we end.
I believe we need to unite it. Like today, we learning one another and passing resource and benefit everyone who need that resource. And yes, I'm glad to be here and meet Tameka and Kassie. That way we can maybe call and send an email and ask for more information for people in the community. Thank you.
Yes, and I mean, one thing I'll say is in some ways, when some of us talk to some of you, in some ways we can give info. In other ways, I think what we're looking to do is get your info, right? Like sort of work with you together to figure out how do we really get people to fight for this, right? And I think it's usually by helping people see, because people are just as smart as we are. They don't need us to tell them anything, right? But it's more like, what are the kinds of things that you're willing to fight for and the ways that you're willing to fight for it? So you want a job, we have some ideas about what might work and kind of some strategies, and then together kind of figure out what works, right? So a lot of it's kind of putting our head together and coming up with some you know, really good plans. I think we have some, but we can always use a lot more. Kassie, do you wanna make a comment before we close?
Yeah, I mean, I very much echo the same kind of spirit of solidarity. It's so important. Like, we live under such a like brutality of capitalism and racism and environmental race. Like these things are all kind of coming after our communities and the folks we care about. And we are all trying to pull these threads. The more that we can pull the threads and get this thing unraveled so that folks can live a good life, the better. It's always very like, it fills my heart to be in a room like this and get to hear from folks, because these are intermingled fights. And if they aren't, then they're the wrong fight.
Thank you very much. Yes. And so we're going to end now. Essentially, I want to just take a chance to say thanks again to Dolores Castañeda, to Kassie Beyer, and to Tameka Gavin for being with us. I also want to thank our interpretation team, Juliana Ramirez and Chris Zaragoza of Somos Sur. We are the South. They've worked with us a lot. And thanks to a lot of you. I say this every single teach in, but I think I'm just going to keep saying it because it's true. And that is that there are people on this webinar who are not panelists, but we can see all the things you're writing. I know for a fact that many of you are leading really important projects and campaigns and organizations. Some of you a little more formally, some of you volunteer, some of you are staff, and then others of you who are not staff at organizations. I know about a lot of personal fights that you've led in your own community. So we really appreciate you joining and supporting. We don't look at it like we're filling your head with brilliant thoughts you've never had, but it's more like we want to share some of the things we're doing, but a lot of you could have run this whole teach-in and could have been the panelists and taken up the whole hour. So I really want to recognize that, because we're not going to win this struggle with three or four like brilliant people leading us, right? We're going to do it when we realize that we're all actually really brilliant. We've just been told that really only a couple people can be smart and the rest of us kind of have to listen. No. When I was in the farm worker movement, we had a saying that every worker is an organizer. And until we get there, we won't win, right? Because they'll isolate two or three of us that have some campaigns going, and they'll sue us for something silly and keep us, you know, off to the side. So thank you so much for attending. I just know a lot of you are doing amazing stuff, and we really appreciate you, and we'll try to support you as well. So we'll be following up with emails on some of these campaigns to figure out how we keep going together. And for now, you know, thank you very, very much, all of you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Have a great evening.
Thank you so much.
Pasen buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes.